Excuse me, okay, time to go. No, no.
Excuse me, man, I have to speak.
No, please.
That's as many as we could hold, I think. All that speaker coming.
Cake.
No. Yeah,
full now. Just about full.
Jam packed.
Man of room. Still coming in. Leave it open so they can hear outside. Leave it open. Let them hear outside.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen of the media, colleagues, Mr. Leader, good morning.
Morning.
I've submitted to the Speaker of the House of Assembly my letter of resignation as the Member of Parliament for North Abaco. My resignation becomes effective on Friday, the 31st of August, 2012. I propose to return to Parliament on the 25th of this month and make my farewell address to the House of Assembly. I thank God for the life, strength, and skills he gave me to serve our people these many years in the arena of government. I thank once again the good people of North Abaco, who have elected me to represent them as their Member of Parliament on 8 consecutive occasions. It is a privilege I will always hold dear. I was happy to be able to spend last weekend in my constituency together with my wife Dolores and my youngest daughter, and to meet with many of the residents as my political relationship with them comes to an end. Of course, my home is Abaco, more specifically Cooperstown, where I was raised as a child, and where I continue to maintain a residence at the same location where I lived with my grandparents as a child. I fully expect, therefore, to spend a great deal of time in the future among the people who I've been fortunate to represent in Parliament. I thank the Free National Movement for the honor of leading our great party for 19 years. While my leadership of the party has come to an end, I remain a full and faithful member, committed to working where and when our party leadership requires for the benefit of our party, but most especially for the benefit of our people and our country. I owe a special debt of gratitude to all the Bahamian people for the generosity of their support, which permitted me to serve as Prime Minister for 15 years. Our people have always been my inspiration. Whatever I've accomplished in making the quality of life for Bahamians better over the last 35 years is the best expression of my love and appreciation for the opportunities afforded me by this country and its people. I thank my wife Dolores, my children, and my entire family for their unwavering support over my entire political career. Without their agreement and support, my national service would not have been possible. It has been a singular privilege and honor to serve in the August House of Assembly of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. I will now take questions from the press.
Hi, good afternoon, Prime Minister.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Your effective date is the end of August. Is that for the purpose of allowing the North Abaco prospective candidate to meet residency requirement?
Well, there are three purposes. First of all, the leader of the party asked me to consider not resigning forthwith, and I gave the matter my most mature consideration. Secondly, I think the Bahamian people ought to have an opportunity to reflect upon a proposed referendum and to be educated and informed about it. And I want to make sure it's not rushed by the government. And it's been said that I have some part to play in when it's going to come. So I've now played my hand in terms of when it might come. Thirdly, and this is probably the most important one, Greg Gomez, who was one of the four persons who applied to the party for nomination, has spent some time in the United States of America. And he hasn't been back home quite a year yet. He has applied. I want him to be considered, like the other four, as a candidate. and my postponement will facilitate that. His father has been my supporter for many years. In fact, all the candidates have been my supporters at some time or the other. Greg has a wonderful story to tell as to how he was victimized by this government, and I want him to tell it in his own words, and I want him to be given the opportunity. So I hope the party will look at him and the others and make a decision. And whatever decision they make, I hope Greg will be able to tell his story on the campaign trail, whether he's the candidate or not. No, there are many lies told about me, my dear, quite often. There's never been any time when I thought about staying on.
Did you give consideration, Mr. Ingram?
In fact, quite frankly, there's been a twist in what I said. I said on the night of election that I don't intend to take my seat in House of Assembly. In order for me to have a seat, I have to come and swear in. So I come and swear in, and then they say, oh, he changed his mind. No, he didn't change his mind. He came to swear in to be a member of the House, and thereafter he is able to resign.
Mr. Ingram, did you give consideration prior to the election that you would step down as Member of Parliament if the epidemic lost?
That question doesn't arise. There was no circumstance under which a leader such as myself, who's been leader of a party for 19 years, can take a party into election, lose the election, and who wants to stay on. If you were a young person, a one first shot, take Minnis, for instance, as a new leader of the party, if he takes the party into the election and the party loses, he ought to offer his resignation, but the party might well say to him, fine, we think you ought to stay because, you know, we think you have opportunities for the future. Someone like me who served for 3 terms, it's unthinkable at age 64, 65 in a couple of weeks' time that I would stay on. That's unthinkable. And why would I stay on to be a member of Parliament? What is there in that for me? I've spent more than half of my life in the House of Assembly. 35 years, I'm now 64. More than half of my life. It's time for me to go. People have told me it's time for me to go, and I'm happy to go. Thank you very much.
You knew that prior to the election that you were 64 years old. I mean, wouldn't that have played some role in your decision to leave? Or
the answer I gave you remains the same. Next question, please. No, I don't wish to clarify anything. My record stands very clear. They can tell as many lies as they like. I shall have my opportunity to speak, and I will speak. And I hope you listen when I speak. Because I have now postponed my retirement until the 31st of August, and I want to be respectful of the rules of the House. The rules of the House says that if a member doesn't come for 3 months, the member will vacate his seat. Mm-hmm. I am not a Vincent Peet. I am not the PLP. And so I will come to respect the rules of the House of Assembly and use the opportunity to say goodbye to the House.
I didn't hear you earlier, but you were saying something about the referendum and the timing of it. But I wanted to ask, do you intend to vote and what do you intend to vote?
You know, it is mind-boggling to wrap your head around a referendum that's going to be to decide whether or not gaming can take place by the illegal number operations in the Bahamas, and whether you should have a national lottery. But the Bahamians will not have an opportunity to determine whether or not they can gamble in the casino.
That's right.
If you're going to put the question of gambling to the public of the Bahamas, then the whole question must be put. You must bear in mind that we are singular in our decision in the Bahamas that excludes its citizens from being able to gamble in the casino. Nobody else in the world does that. That's because of our own peculiar history. In 1965, when the decision was made, it was also determined that Bahamians could not be croupiers in the casino. That you had to be from the Western Europe. You had to be Italian or one of them to be a casino croupier in the Bahamas. No Bahamian was a croupier in the Bahamas. In fact, at the time of independence in 1973, the then Prime Minister said at a press conference that as long as he was Prime Minister, there would never be a Bahamian croupier in the casinos in the Bahamas, because that was the established policy. they change their mind over time. The public of the Bahamas ought to have a right to decide whether they want to gamble in the casino or not. Secondly, I don't know why it should be assumed that we should spend all this money on a referendum to deal with the question of gambling when there are some issues. Like, for instance, I want you, as a female in this country, to have the same rights I have under the Constitution. There are many other important issues in the Bahamas. And so I would like for, and when I last had a referendum, the argument was the public was not educated. But I don't see anything happening about educating the public about the referendum. And so I'd like to postpone it as much as I could so the public can be educated. Because you can't put it forward and then say your hands are clean. So you can't make a deal with the number fellas before election, get their money, and then call upon me to support you or to vote for it. So you asked me the question whether I'm going to vote or not. I wouldn't waste my time on such a referendum. I would not waste my time on that.
Yes.
No, I said in 2010, yeah, when the church leaders were making noise, I said that
were
we
you
cannot.
Proposing a casino?
I said we would have a referendum. I didn't say specifically what it would conclude, but I would not have had a referendum that did not include the casino.
Right.
That would be unthinkable.
Is there a difference between a constitutional referendum and a popular referendum?
I assume so.
Don't require a change of the constitution.
Oh, this one doesn't require a change in the Constitution. This only helps the government decide what it wants to do. This only helps the number of fellas get what they pay it for. When they pay it big.
You're saying you don't need a referendum?
No. But it's a divisive issue. And so it is a legitimate question for the government to want to put to the public of the Bahamas. But it should be a question about gambling, about gaming, not limited to a national lottery and whether or not Flowers and the Lucky Five or whatever they are can have these things. And they still draw on all them, etc.
There have been numerous accusations about victimization since the new administration came to office. More recently, claims related to the possible administrator. What are your observations sitting back and watching all of this? And do you agree that there has been evidence of victimization since the new administration?
Unquestionably so. The young man about whom I speak, Greg Gomez, was selected by the public sector to be a Family Island administrator, had already reported for duty. The election came and he was told, no, you can't be hired. He made an appointment to see the minister. The minister gave him the appointment and then didn't see him. He was told by the senior official that, oh, you know why? You're red. And she pointed to the color on her dress. He'll be able to tell his own story. What has happened at the hospital with Adley McMillan is a clear case of victimization. You know, Gomez has an issue with Coralie. He has a personal issue with her. In fact, I'd like to report that on two occasions, while I was prime minister between 2007 and now, Gomez had occasion to call me to complain about what he said was happening to him that he thought was unfair and or wrong. And I, on both occasions, caused the matter to be resolved in his favor. Unfortunately for Coralie, she doesn't now have a prime minister who is able to review and make determinations like he had when I was in office. Secondly, let me say on this, that Coralie, up to today, does not yet have a letter in her hand from the government or the PHA telling her that she has been dismissed or that her contract is being terminated. If you decide that you don't want Coralie anymore, the least you ought to do is pay her the balance of her contract, which is about 17 months. I had a part in recruiting her back to the hospital in 2001. She served the FNM. She served the PLP from 2000 to 2007, Dr. Marcus Bettel and Dr. Bernard Nottage, Minister of Health. They had no difficulties. She served Dr. Minnis, no difficulty. How is it that Gomez come in 6 weeks' time, he has a difficulty? It is personal. It is wrong. I condemn it in the strongest possible term. She's a very good and capable officer. She's managed the place well. In fact, the employees at the place have not yet been told by the PHA that she's going to go. Everything that's been said about it was in the newspaper. They had to read the Nassau Guardian. No respect whatsoever. Total diss. Tell me where and when and how and who. Just tell me. They were not employees. Steve McKinney and those were on the radio telling people the election was not over, the PLB was coming back, and we were not going to have the public broadcasting station abused in that fashion. It's being abused now. I heard Keishley Smith on the TV the other night talking about how I have been missing in action and how I have disdained the parliament and the rest of it. Most unbecoming. It's been turned into a propaganda station. I now listen to Channel 12 News, and I ask the public of the Bahamas to start watching them too. Everything is wrong in the Bahamas. I did, and all that's good they did. They seek to take credit for everything I did, and discredit anything that they don't like. No, I don't have any comments to make about them. They are exactly what I expected them to be. The public of the Bahamas bought them. They've got them, and that's what you're gonna get. I'm gonna ask answers.
She couldn't get it in.
Oh, okay. It is not for me to assess your performance. It is for you to assess your performance. It's for you to assess your performance. It's for you who are in the media, who are becoming public relations props for the government. That you go around and you see them taking a bulldozer, knocking a house down. And nobody would say, listen, can the government do this? Aren't there laws that govern this? I didn't miss your story. I saw your story, and I saw Algernon Allen speaking on your TV, and I saw how he was hoodwinking your reporter. Because you must give the occupier notice, you must give the owner notice, and they must have an opportunity to make representation. You cannot just go and do so. That's what distinguishes a democracy from a totalitarian society. We would all like to be able to clean up all the old cars that are around the place. Just go and pick them up and carry them. All the old houses and the rest of it, etc. But the reality is that there are laws and there are rules that you ought to abide by, and the government ought to set the example. But yes, you did do a story. You also did a wonderful story on the question of these police shootings. You know, we have a high crime problem in society. But what you cannot do is permit policemen to act outside the law. That it cannot be that you shoot two armed robbers or crooks one night and you tell me nothing about it. I just shot them, they're dead. You must explain to me. I'm a public. You have a right to shoot when you are threatened. You don't have a right to willy-nilly go and shoot somebody. Or to have a commissioner of police who now had a new tone, who tells us this story about what a wonderful thing is happening. These are not the stories he told me when I was in office. About urban renewal. These are not the same stories. But maybe I was mistaken then. Maybe my eyes are clear now. I said what I wanted to say. I didn't say any more than that. But I would be happy to say more than that if it's a response to what I say.
Okay. So you contend that as former Minister Lang does, that his comments relative to urban...
Most inappropriate. Most inappropriate. He had all the tools he needed to do the job. All the tools. There was never a request from the police that wasn't honored. In fact, we gave the police more than they asked for. And the police is most fully resourced today. Fully resourced today.
What would you say is your greatest accomplishment, sir? Would it be more than
leaving here with my head held high?
Yeah.
Well, the police are supposed to facilitate and accommodate people against whom there's a threat. If you are a high-risk person, then the police ought to be able to give you additional protection and or, in some cases, permit you to carry an arm. I never had to carry any arms. No minister of mine ever had to carry any arms. And so the police have made their decision. I mean, normally what happens is the commissioner will speak to the prime minister about whether or not a gun should be issued to Jack or to Harry, and clearly, if it is deemed that such a person is a high-risk person, then they would arm them. So I can't judge them on that. Yes. No, this government is going to spend the next 5 years completing my agenda, darling. We will.
How?
What do you mean, how? How do you do it? We have all the monies we need to run the by-election.
Yes.
All the monies we need. We've already started to pay down the debt we had since the election. We will pay it off. Left me what? Broken? What do you mean by broken? What do you mean? Well, just wait and see, my dear. The FNM, that's okay. No, please. The FNM is a strong, vibrant organization. It has many, many people and supporters. It got 65,000 votes in the last election. It went in the election with a bad economy, a terrible economy, and it did very well under those circumstances. And so, no, I have no concern or fear about that. The FNM will bounce back. They call me many things. What they could say about me was that I ran a disciplined ship. That every Tom, Dick, and Harry didn't have his own policy. That everybody didn't have to be able to announce he's going to do this. That the Deputy Prime Minister goes to Grand Bahama. He announces that they're going to take the building that the government bought for the Public Hospitals Authority. For the expansion of the Rand Hospital, he says they're going to make it a home for the homeless. The Prime Minister goes down a couple of days later, saying, oh, they changed their mind about that. They're going to make it administrative offices. Leslie Miller makes an announcement as to what he's going to do. And then the minister comes behind, he says something different. The Prime Minister makes a comment about gambling. His parliamentary secretary, on the same day, same newscast, makes something different. And so it goes on and on and on. No, those who know me know better, but that's a charge they put on me. They call me many things. But you've never had so much, for a dictator to have so much freedom, for you to be working where you're working, you and all of you, et cetera, et cetera. That's not the actual dictator. That's not the actual dictator. I'm not looking forward to it, but if it comes, it's fine. Like I said before, I can go to any inquiry, any day, unaccompanied by anyone, no lawyer, no nothing, no papers, no nothing. These hands are clean, and I'd be happy to go any day, any day. Make myself available any day. They have no choice.
They're not steering off course.
They have no choice.
Right.
But they have no choice. They have no choice. They have no choice to do that. They have no choice in complete the airport gateway project. They have no choice. They have no choice but to complete the New Province Road Improvement Project. These are agreements with international organizations, and or with the Chinese government, the Chinese banks. They're not stupid. He's a very sensible man. I don't think he's making a bid to do so. I don't think so. I don't think so. I think that's all fluff. I think that's all fluff. And I believe that the owners of BTC believe that is all fluff. What I do wish to say is that it would be wonderful if the government would proceed with the plans left in place by the FNM to sell 9% of the shares in BTC to the public of the Bahamas at the same price we sold the cable and wireless. That would produce some revenue for them and also broaden the ownership base of the company in the hands of ordinary Bahamians. I think if you keep listening to Mr. Christie and listen carefully, you will find Mr. Christie says many things that don't connect with anything else. It's coming. It's coming. They're going to deliver. Now, whether it's going to be effective or not is another matter, but they're going to deliver. They'll deliver something. I just told you my statement. I'll be available for the leadership, whatever they want me to do. Yes. Outside of being involved in politics myself. Everything that they announced of any consequence in their budget communication was left in place by the FNM. Left in place. They are yet to produce something that they are doing. Urban renewal 2.0, yes. Knocking down people's houses, yes. Tell me what else they're doing.
Mr. Ingram, how would you account for the $500 million deficit?
I can start off by accounting for the first of all, is the first $50 million of it is because we have to pay Obama for the deal that Christie made with them. Mm-hmm. That'll take us down to $454 million, eh? Mm-hmm. And secondly, I'd take $15 million off that they're putting in for their program. All right? That'll take it down to 400 and some million, eh? All right, thanks. You can't blame me for their ignorance, if they are ignorant. You can't blame me for that.
Yeah, but they're saying that your administration spent money recklessly.
But why wouldn't they stop it? Why wouldn't they stop it? Why would they stop it? If you had a deficit last year of $500 million, which I dispute, why would you now make it $550 on your watch? No, why would you do it on your watch? If you say you are disciplined, why would you do it next year? Unless you have some people who are foolish enough to believe you, then you tell them Ingram did this.
But they claim, sir, that the jobs program, that it ballooned from $25 to $48 billion.
We announced that during the campaign. I said we had hired more than 4,000 people. And the same thing they said. It's all about people. Invest in people. Now, the people who are getting fired are Bahamians. None of the foreign contractors are getting fired, you know. None. Only Bahamians. But they believe in Bahamians.
I don't
want to get into that. That's a private company.
How confident are you that the gentleman at your right can lead the FNM into the 2017 election successfully?
How confident am I? Mm-hmm. I was confident I was going to win. So what do you mean, how confident I am? Absolutely.
What do you have to do to get to that point?
Very little. The PLP can make sure you win. Just be here. When they finish doing what they're doing, the people of the Bahamas are going to be happy to have the FNM.
There are people who would say that about what just happened.
Well, and that'll be their right to say it. I just say what I wanted to say. And if you want to speak for them, you can speak for them.
If your name is offered for a knighthood,
Oh, please, that's out of the question. That's out of the question. That's out of the question. I left three knighthoods on the table. Can I finish, please? Mm-hmm. I left three knighthoods on the table that Christie can dispense to whoever he wishes.
But my question is,
and the answer is no. Absolutely not. Under no circumstance. Under no circumstance. How many times would I answer you? Why is this blue? It's blue, eh? No. This is blue because it's blue, eh? Oh, and I say no because it is no. Okay?
Why
did I put on the suit this morning? I did. No. The last prime minister of the Bahamas who...
North beginning, and also the move, to, the talk of a move to re-engineer the iGroup deal.
First of all, I would have hoped that you would have gone to Bimini to see this casino they're talking about, to find out where these 1,000 jobs are coming from, or these 300 jobs are coming from. I would have thought you'd go and investigate since they announced it. I'm not aware of anything that's happened to the I Group. Somebody made some off-the-wall comment about the I Group, and they took it back the next morning, etc. As far as we're concerned, we did the deal with the I Group. They were very happy with the deal we did. And if they want to change it, it's entirely up to them. We got the land back for the people of Marijuana. Mm-hmm. We're certainly going to stand here and let the PLP give it back to no foreigners, okay? That's fine. The government's entitled to do that. They voted for them. They voted for each one of them. Mm-hmm. They voted for each one of them. But if they have a change of heart, it's okay. During the elections, they said they wanted stronger crime laws. That's what they had. Stronger laws. Stiffer sentences. When they win, the exact opposite. Exact opposite. Tough on crime. That's reality. Yes, Tanika. That's not true. That's totally untrue. In fact, some mischievous person gave that story to the Tribune, and I was very disappointed the Tribune gave it such a big banner headline, especially from a story that had no source. It had no source, and secondly, it didn't even have the name of the writer of the story on it. It was a very platted story, and I think the Tribune did the FM a great disservice by blowing it up that way, unless somebody was prepared to step forward and say, listen, I stand behind this. Now, they may well have had some comments they didn't want carried and call it a source, but they had to have a source who's named to carry such a damaging story against the party.
Mr. Ingram, before the election, The Guardian ran a story about a scandal within the Ministry of Tourism with Foreign Minister Vincent van der Poel Wallace.
Mm-hmm.
Could you explain any what your understanding of that is and what action you took?
No, because you said what action I took. The same story you said what action I took. Said I canceled the contract.
The same story
you carried the facts. And since that time, you carried the story again, except this time you made it sound like, is this Prime Minister?
No.
No, I'm saying you carried the same story again after election, except on the second occasion, The Guardian made it appear as though it was this Prime Minister's office that is dealing with this contract. All right? And so we would be delighted for them to put all the facts on the table. Sorry. All the facts on the table, including the decisions taken by the Prime Minister of the Bahamas.
Did you
all the facts.
That there was any wrongdoing on behalf of, on the part of your tourism?
I said that you put all the facts on the table. They gave you all the facts. They gave them all to you. Frankie Wilson and those had all of you all come to see them, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and look at the facts. Don't ask me. Read it. And then ask me. Did I not answer you this now?
I suppose you did.
Yes, I did. Ladies and gentlemen of the press, thank you very much. Good morning. It's hot in here.